Good afternoon, all of you. Yesterday we had a discussion about the important characteristic features of the insects coming under the order Coleoptera. As we know that the Coleoptera is the largest order, like one in every four insects, what you see on this earth, like 25% of all the insect species on this earth, they are coming under the order Coleoptera. It means that's the largest order. And we also understand why this is called as Coleoptera, because coleo means sheath-like. They have a sheath-like wings, the four wings, what we call them as elytra. They are very tough, highly sclerotized, sheath-like, protecting the hind wing, which are membranous, and also protecting the entire body. They are very, very colorful, and these elytra are really tough. And also, I presented a small picture yesterday that this elytra, because they have a wonderful, colorful, bright colors, these elytra are also used as a jewelry purposes. And we also had a discussion that the adults are also causing damage, and some of these adults are also phytophagous. But the most important stage is the grubs and the caterpillar, nothing but caterpillars. The caterpillars of these coleopterans, we call them as a grubs. And these grubs can be of two types. That's what we had a discussion. These grubs can be of two types. The grubs can be a scarabi form, like C shape, and the campodi form, like a alligator. And also we had a discussion yesterday about the important characteristic features of two families within the order Coleoptera. One is the coccinellids, ladybird beetles. And we have seen some small video how these ladybird beetles, both adults and also the grubs, are the caterpillars, the larvae, what we call. We call them as a larvae of coleopterans as a grubs. So you have seen the grubs and also adults, how they would like to eat the aphids and the smaller insects and also eggs. And all these coleopterans, both adults and also larva, which is nothing but grub, they have a very, very well-developed mandibulate mouthparts, a chewing and biting kind of mouthparts. That is the reason they are very, very successful, and they eat any kind of food for that matter. They live in water, they live in humus, they live in soil, they live in plants. The habitat is very much varying. The habits, food habits are very much varying. And the sizes are also very much varying from small to bigger ones. So with this background, we will continue from the previous class, trying to understand about the important characters of the family Scarabidae. Scarabids are also called as horn beetles or dung rollers. Scarabids are also called as a horn beetles or dung rollers, and also called as a root grubs. They have a horn-like projection on the head. Looks like actually a rhinoceros. That is the reason we call them as a rhinoceros beetle. And in this picture, it's very clear that you can as well see these dung rollers very commonly. And the grubs of these insects are polyphagous, and mostly they eat on the roots of the plants. That is the reason we call them as a root grubs. A Yesterday we tried to have a briefing about these important characters of the insects coming into the family Scarabidae. They are very, very stout body and elongated body. Head will have, depends upon the insect to insect, but generally they will have some kind of tooth kind of structure or bifurcated frontal horn. Antenna is always a lamellate kind of antenna. And the prothorax is large. Sometimes they have a horny like of structures. We call them as a horn beetles. In this case, the elytra will not usually cover the abdomen completely. You can see in the picture here, the elytra is actually not covering the abdomen completely. And the tarsal formula is always 5-5-5, like tarsal segments are always 5 in the foreleg, midleg and also hind legs. These adults, they usually live on the foliage, they keep on eating the leaves, but the grubs are always in the soil in most of the cases, and they are C-shaped. Usually their head is highly sclerotized and some kind of light brown color, whereas the entire body is white in color and looks like a fleshy. They have a wonderful, highly developed true legs. Segmented true legs in the thoracic region. And they are sluggish actually. They don't move. Once they emerge from the egg, they keep on eating the root. They will be always on the underground, and that is the reason they don't move. We call them as a white grubs or root grubs. So these are the common symptoms. This is the damage caused by the coconut rhinoceros beetle. So when this limb is in the fond in the beginning stage, then it must have cut, and that's the reason once it gets developed, it will have this kind of shape. So if you find any coconut tree with this kind of damage symptom, you can easily say that it's because of rhinoceros beetle. Definitely you will find these rhinoceros beetles at the fond. And this is the rhinoceros beetle. You can see this is the rhinoceros beetle, and especially the prothoracic region, it is extended. And these are the grubs. They are white in color, and you can very clearly see the legs, the true legs in the three thoracic segments, and also the wonderful, highly developed, sclerotized mouth parts. And another important thing is root grub of sugarcane, that is Holotrichia consanguina, which is very, very common. And these root grub, the adult beetles are always lives on the neem tree. And they go and lay the eggs in the soil, and then this kind of grubs or larva gets emerged, and they keep on eating the roots. They are very, very dangerous. And I have a small video as far as the insects under the family Scarabidae, and most importantly is about the dung rollers.
Here are true facts about the dung beetle. The dung beetle survives solely by eating the faces of other animals.
And these dung beetles, they solely survive on eating the feces, fecal matter of the other animals.
With its acute sense of smell, the dung beetle then selects a choice piece to roll into a box.
So these dung beetles, the adults, they will select one very tasty pieces of other animals. They will try to make a kind of roll, a ball-like of structure.
Then judge their potential mates by the size of their ball.
So these, they will make a ball from the fecal matter of other animals.
Sir, your mic is muted, sir. You're not audible.
Yeah, what I mean is actually in the previous video, the dung rollers, the dung beetles, they use the fecal matter of other animals as a food materials. And this video is basically to make you understand that these are the very commonly seen smaller beetles available everywhere. And these beetles use the fecal matter of other animals as a food. So they'll make a kind of roll, a ball kind of structure, and how nicely they are actually trying to take the food near to the grubs. The grubs are nothing but larvae of these coleopterans. It's not easy to take the food to the babies, grubs. So that's what I actually want to show you, that these dung rollers, they belong to the family Scarabidae. And the next one is Chrysomelidae. The Chrysomelids, we call them as a flea beetles. Leaf beetles are tortoise beetles. They're very, very dangerous. They look very small and beautiful, but however, they're extremely dangerous for the crops. You can see in the left side picture, this is the paddy. We call them as a paddy hispa. Paddy hispa, it's a beetle actually. So they, you can have some kind of horny kind of structure on the body. And this is another leaf beetle, which is very commonly seen in all of our cucurbits. And this beetle is a tortoise beetle. Probably if you are at the college during this semester, when you go out for collection of the insects, you will definitely find these beetles, especially this red one and also the green one. This is very common. So these flea beetles, leaf beetles and tortoise beetles together, we call them as a Chrysomelids under the family Chrysomelidae of the order Coleoptera. They are usually small to medium. They are actually smaller insects. Oval or spear-shaped beetles with upper surface of the body generally have some kind of shining, in this case here, metallic coloration in most of the cases except this hispa. But generally all these beetles will have a wonderful shining over the body and also especially the elytra part. The antennae is very short and the legs are also short because the beetle is itself short. But the hind femora is enlarged for jumping. Actually, they jump. These beetles can jump because of the enlarged hind femora. Like similarly, if you look into the grasshoppers and locusts, when we had a discussion, the crickets, the hind femora is extremely enlarged, which is used for the jumping purpose. Similarly, in this case, the hind femora is enlarged for jumping purpose. And abdomen is short and they'll have some last five visible sternites. Adults generally feed on the leaves. You can see that here, this is the adult and this is the rice hispa. Telugulo memu tatayaki tegulu antam. So rice hispa, they lay the eggs on the paddy and these larvae which are coming out of the hispa, they do a lot of damage, and even the adults. And similarly, you can see the red pumpkin beetle, Alcophora fecalis. These are the very common. You just go to the pumpkins or cucurbits and you will definitely find these red pumpkin beetles. These adults generally feed on leaves, causing a kind of holes. And these beetles are also feeding on the flowers. And some grubs, especially the rice hispa, for example, in this case, some grubs actually feed on the foliage and acting as a leaf miner. That is the reason I called you like it's tataku tegulu endukantarante ori aakulo aa grubs గీక్కుంటా గీక్కుంటా ఉండటం వల్ల ఆ పర్టికులర్ పార్ట్ ఇట్ లూజ్ ద క్లోరోఫిల్ దట్ ఇస్ ద రీజన్ ఇట్ లుక్స్ లైక్ ఎ వైట్ స్ట్రిప్స్ లుక్ లైక్ ఎ వైట్ స్ట్రిప్స్ దోస్ హూ ఆర్ ఫ్రమ్ అగ్రికల్చర్ పాలిటెక్నిక్ దే నో అబౌట్ దిస్ And some grubs actually feed on the foliage like Rhizospa and others feed on the roots and stems also. But generally, in most of the cases, the adults are extremely dangerous and these adults cause serious damage, causing holes in the leaves. And another interesting and important family is Cerambycidae. Cerambycidae is a long-horned wood-boring beetles. Because the most important interesting characteristic feature is they have a very very long antenna which is sometimes double the size of the body, and at Bapatla you will definitely see these beetles because you have a lot of cashew nut. So cashew nut stem borer is very common in this area of Bapatla, and you will definitely see during the season. Most students, they catch these beetles. The interesting and most important character for the Cerambycidae, what you should remember is they have a long antenna, which is sometimes more than the double the size of the body. These adults actually, they will not cause any disease. These adults will not cause any disease, but their grubs are very, very serious pests of the crops. Just imagine these beetles will lay the eggs in a stem and the grub will come out, and these grub keep on eating the wood of a tree like cashew nut or mango or the grape sometimes. And once it eats the entire pith material of the stem, sometimes you will see, because of the damage of these bigger plants by few of these beetle grubs, the entire plant will die. You will lose the crop. You see, just imagine a 20 years age cashew nut is dying just because of these things. It's a very, very pathetic situation. This is very, very dangerous insects. The beetles will not cause any disease, but their grubs are really dangerous. And this family is Cerambycidae, a long horn wood boring beetles. So the entire body is also elongated body. You can see here in all these pictures, the body is elongated and cylindrical beetles. The most important is they have a very long filiform or serrated. So in this case it is serrated, in this case it's a filiform. At least 2/3 as long as body, but generally it can extend even the double the size of the body. The prothorax, you can see the prothorax is narrow, and this prothorax usually will have some kind of spines, spiny kind of structures. In this case, the elytra covers the entire body. You can see here, the elytra covers the entire body. Sometimes may leave one or two last segments which gets exposed, but otherwise the elytra completely covers the body. Legs, they have a very, very, actually these insects are very tough, and whenever our students, our college students, they get catch hold of these things, it's very, very difficult to kill them. And also very difficult to kill them. And also very difficult to pin them. Not easy. Very tough. The elytra is really tough. And these beetles you will see very commonly at Bapatla. And the grubs are tree borers. That's what I told you. All these grubs are tree borers. We call them as a stem borers or tree borers. Adults may feed on the flowers, But these adults will actually produce some kind of sounds when they catch them. The most important point as far as the cerambe seeds are concerned, the body you should always remember is the body is elongated, cylindrical, and the antenna is very long, either serrate or filiform ambenta, but the antenna is very long and sometimes more than 2 times of the body size. These are the 2 important points, and the 3rd important point is the grubs are tree borers. The grubs are the tree borers. We'll go to the next family, Curculinidae. Curculinidae, we call them as a weevils or snout beetles because their mouth is extended like a snout, whereas the mouth parts are always present in the end of the snout. These are very, very commonly seen, and the most important and interesting for you is you will see some of the smaller beetles in the rice floor at your home. You will see these weevils also, the black color weevils in the rice floor at your home. We call them as a snout beetles because the head is prolongated or elongated into a form kind of snout, and at the end of the snout the mouth parts are present. And this one is extremely dangerous. We call them as a coconut weevil. We call them as a red palm weevil. And this red palm is a very, very dangerous pest, not only in India and also entire Southeast Asia and all the parts. It not only damages the coconut, but also damages all the palms. And this is one of the very important pests as far as all these desert countries where a lot of palm trees are present. And they are all somber colored. When you disturb them, these weevils, even the rice floor, you can catch hold. When you disturb them, they will actually draw their legs underside the body, and as if they behave, they will act like as if they are dead so that you don't kill them. And that's what is the important character. So when you disturb them, they draw their legs and antenna, everything, and fall to the ground and remain motionless and behave like as if they are dead. They actually act. Most important character, you can see the head is prolongated to form some kind of snout or rostrum. And you can as well see the antenna here. And that's the reason we call them as a snout beetles. And in females, actually, this snout is also used for boring into the wood for laying the eggs. They will simply bore into the wood with the help of snout, and then they lay the eggs. And the antenna is always geniculate. You can see here in this picture, the antenna is geniculate. The mouth parts are actually small and they are arranged at the end of the snout, at the tip of the snout. Legs are short and sometimes they are very long. But the important character is, you can see the coxa are trochanter here. The trochanter is elongated. You can see here. The trochanter, the second segment, is too much elongated. That's very important taxonomic characters. The grubs are apodous, they don't have legs, and curved. And all these grubs are always present inside the tree. Both adults and also grubs are phytophagous, and some are stored grain pests. That's what I told you, you have a rice weevil, which is a very small insect you will definitely find at your home. And these are the common examples. That's what I am trying to show. This is the rice weevil. This rice weevil is very commonly seen at our home. You can catch, you can see it today. This is the coconut red palm weevil, which is a very dangerous and international pest. This is the rice weevil. This is the sweet potato weevil. And this is the mango stone weevil, Stenocatus mangifera. And Citophilus varese is very commonly seen at, even at our home. And the last one is Epionidae, epear-shaped weevils. And here, the antenna is clavate, you can see, rarely geniculate, but the entire body, the abdominal segments, they look like a, some kind of pear shape. And that's the reason we call them as a pear-shaped weevils, all these epionids. And the most important example is jute stem weevil. So with this, we end this session for today. And then we try to learn in this lecture, in this class, as much as possible about the important characteristic features of the insects coming under the coleoptera. Remember, this is the largest order. And very, very economically, very important for all of us to remember the important characteristic features of the insects coming under coleoptera. And also a few important families. Thank you very much. And see you again. The next class, we are going to discuss about another important order is nothing but Hymenoptera.